Good morning, everyone. So my name is Lakmal, and so I am working mainly on Apache projects. So I'm a VP of Apache Stratos project, which is I'm talking about today, what you can get from Apache Stratos and how you can run containers in production, ready setup with Apache Stratos. And I also working at WSO2 as a director cloud architecture as my day job. Okay, this is the agenda for today's session. So first I will introduce what is Apache Stratos and what are the capabilities of Stratos. Then I will talk about why Docker can't run in production standalone and what are the issues, and then how you can overcome with helping other open source projects make a production ready cloud with the Docker container support. And then later I will do some demo using how you can deploy Docker, and you can how you can update your application, and you can how auto scale your application based on the policies you have defined in your Apache Stratos project. Okay, so Apache Stratos is, I would say, is a platform as service framework. Why is that? So you can create your own platform as service using Apache Stratos. I will explain more detail how you can do it. So in Apache Stratos, we have a concept called cartridges. So that are your PaaS runtime components that build top of the Apache Stratos project. So initially, this is developed by the WSO2, and in 2013, we have donated into the Apache Software Foundation, and now we are graduated and we are top-level project in the Apache Software Foundation. And now we are very closely collaborating with the Cisco and other several companies to make this a very competitive product in the frameworks. Okay, so let's dig into the architecture. So you can see in the bottom layer, there's an infrastructure service layer. If you take the platform as a service, it will require infrastructure service to run. So in Stratos, you can run top of many infrastructure services. Top of, like I would say, for example, Amazon EC2, OpenStack, all version of OpenStack, CloudStack, GCE. So we are supporting more than 30 plus infrastructure services that run top of, we can run top of these infrastructure services. How we can support? So we have integrated with the Apache JCloud, another Apache project. So there is an abstraction layer. They are providing APIs, single APIs to communicate underlying infrastructure services. So they are supporting more than 30 plus. That means we also supporting more than 30 plus infrastructure services. This is very important. So if you choose a platform as service in your company or in your application in production, you are not to a particular vendor lock. So you can either migrate or you can run top of many infrastructure services that help you to do the not to do the vendor locking scenarios. And with the latest release, so we are supporting containers running the Apache Stratos. How we are supporting? We are using this Kubernetes open source project. It's initially developed by the Google. And last year, in July, they have open source, and now there are a lot of other companies involved developing this project. So I will explain what these projects do. So using this Kubernetes API, we are supporting the containers. So at the moment, we are supporting Docker container, but we can support either Rocket or any other containers technology using this underneath to run container. And also, we have integrated the mock IIS. So that is we developed by the Apache Stratos project. This is mainly focusing on the development of PaaS framework, because if you take the PaaS framework development, you need to have infrastructure ready and a lot of required these resources. Then developers can't get this kind of thing. But with choosing the mock IIS, you can do every functional testing or development that you need to develop on the Apache Stratos project. Then in the top layer, the middle layer, so there's a Stratos components that help to do all these functionality. Mainly, we have Stratos Manager, which exposes the set of APIs to manage your platform as a service. And also, it's coming with the some command line tool and the graphical interface UI to manage this PaaS framework. And also, we have an important component called Artifact Distribution Coordinator. So why we need this kind of component? For example, if you deploy your service into 100 instances, then how do you update this artifacts? Then you need to have some kind of mechanism to update all the clusters when you update the application. So that's why the Artifact Distribution Coordinator comes into picture. I will demonstrate how happening in my demonstration. And next, we have this auto-scale component in the middle. So that is responsible for the scale up or down based on the load that's coming into the particular service. It may be a HTTP load, it may be non-HTTP load. So I will explain how you can do multi-factored auto-scaling using this component and the mechanism we are using. Also, we have integrated the real-time complex event processor mainly to the real-time analytics of the your health statistics published by the every instances. So that is very important. So since this is supporting auto-scaling and scaling down, up and down, then we need to analyze all this data in real-time, get the decisions, okay, when I need to scale up or need to scale down some scenario. And so by default, we are supporting three load balancers at the moment. Nginx, HAProxy, and Stratos Load Balancer. But the architecture is very flexible. You can bring any third-party load balancers in with minimum effort. I will explain how you can do it. Currently, we are there's a two Google Summer of Code project, two students doing that, integrate with the GCE and the Amazon AWS load balancers into the Apache Stratos project. And this layer is the cartridges, we call it cartridges. If you look at the, that is a small run, standalone runtime for this PaaS. So for example, if you want to say Tomcat, and if you want to have some, say MongoDB, so you can create a cartridges. Then using this small standalone components, you can build your application. So if you look at the microservice architecture, this is like a small microservices that builds as a cartridges. Then combining this all these cartridges, you can build your application the way supporting the microservices. So let me move into the next slide. So like I said, so Stratos is a polyglot PaaS. That means there's no limitation as a, you can bring any framework cartridges, you can bring any app server, data sources, or you can bring your own cartridges, legacy app as a cartridges. So that's another important thing. So because cartridge is like a business logic plus Stratos agent. So agent is communicating with your business logic and the Stratos components at the middle tier. So you can bring your own legacy into the cartridges, and you can get the benefit that coming from the Apache Stratos PaaS framework. So that's the very good thing. You can there's no boundaries. You can bring any type of cartridges. Okay, so we'll talk about why Docker standalone in not production, not ready in the production at the moment. So if you look at one thing is the networking, Docker networking. So say if you deploy your Docker container in two different Docker host machine, you can't communicate using the Docker private IP addresses. So that make very hard time to bring into the enterprise application. You can't do the like caching or clustering across these two Docker host containers running on two Docker host machine. So that's the number one limitation. So for that, there are a lot of open source projects. So we have integrated them into the Stratos, Apache Stratos project. I will explain what are them. And then the as a concept, the if you take the microservice architecture, so the what we are recommending it run single process in single container. So if you take that concept, but into the enterprise apps, you can't have single processors, right? Take simple example, maybe a Tomcat. So Tomcat running in a JVM, and also for the log roller, we need to run cron job or whatever the, another processors. So by design, it's not recommended to run in single container. Then how you can overcome this? So I will explain what are the other projects you can overcome, use this, overcome this thing. And also then if you run in multiple containers in multiple processors, then how is the sharing happening? What is the network sharing, or what is the process sharing? How can you do that? So these are the things that you have to think about. Okay, when you run in production cluster, you can't run Docker standalone. You have to get other open source project involved at the current movement. So this is the latest release we are working on. We did the RC2 and we are working on RC3. Hopefully we are going with the GA with RC3. So with 4.0 release, we are mainly focused on two major features. That is the containerization support, mainly Docker support, and next is the composite application support. So with the containerization support, we have indicated with CoreOS. How many of you heard about CoreOS? Okay, good. Kubernetes, how many of you heard about Kubernetes? Great. So, and Fanel, Discover services, we have indicated all these services to make the container run in production environment. Okay, so I will explain in one slide with the CoreOS. So CoreOS bring the production quality host my OS to run in Docker. So that's the main idea. So they have indicated with the systemd, like if you take the normal Linux system, you have the init system to manage the processors. But there's no API, external APIs to control this init system. So what CoreOS guys do is it will did the open systemd to control from the APIs, then you can deploy, manage the processors inside the CoreOS machine. And with the fleet and ECTD, they can scheduling across the multiple Docker cluster. Yeah, this is a slide. You can have the multiple Docker clusters running, and you can do scheduling with the defined algorithms. And then the Fanel comes into the picture. This is again CoreOS project. So like I say, if you run two Docker containers in two different host machines, you can't communicating using the private IP. So that's the one problem. So that's the solution is, one is a Fanel, and there's another project called Weaver, also doing the same thing. So they are providing the OLA network across these Docker host machines. Then within this OLA network, you can communicate using the private IP addresses. So they care about the routing part of that. So that bring easier to the developer and the DevOps to do the clustering and other normal standard enterprise application practices. And then the Kubernetes mainly do the managing the Docker orchestration part. So I explained, this is initiated by Google. Now it is there are IBM, CoreOS, Microsoft, Red Hat. They're all people are helping to develop Kubernetes project. So it is very very active project and very good project. So I will explain the few of Kubernetes concept that help to overcome what I explained earlier, the problems. So one concept is a pod. So the one problem is that how you can run, since Docker is meant to run single processor in a single container, how you can run enterprise apps within several Dockers and sharing the namespace and networking kind of thing. So the Kubernetes project came up with a concept called pod. That is collection of containers, but they make sure run in a single host machine. Say if you take the same example, Tomcat, if you run Logroller separately and the JVM in a separate container, but if you deploy this pod in the cluster, it makes sure it's running a single host machine. But you can replicate the pod different host machine, but in the single pod, it will run in a single host machine. Then you can share in the network namespace, you can share the PID namespace, you can share in the file system namespace. So you can do whatever you want to do in normal container. So that bring the isolation, but bring the connectivity between these containers. That number one cool thing the Kubernetes project bring into the container world. And next thing is this service proxy. So like, say if you deploy your application in the service in containers, then if you look at the microservice architecture, then you have to interact with two components in the services. Then how you can communicate. Say some services may scale up to five instances, so services need to be accessed that. Then either we have to go either five IP addresses and access it. But the Kubernetes services, they are with a proxy service, you can just access to that proxy service, it will do the load balancing across these five services. So then you can do the easy microservice-based architecture in your application. And also, this is example how Kubernetes run in a CoreOS machine. So in the host machine, they are running CAdvisor mainly for the monitoring of the containers, and Kubernetes is mainly the agent for who doing the scheduling all in the, inside the host machine, and proxy service and the ports. Okay, so this is the L1 architecture, how we are supporting the containers in Apache Stratos project. So see, in the cloud controller, we are included the Apache JCloud for mainly communicating with underlying IISs, like OpenStack EC2. For the container support, we have indicated this Kubernetes client to communicate the APIs to create the containers in the defined cluster. And for the CEP, complex event processor, all the containers can publish their health into the CEP, and then it will do the real-time analytics of the health of this published health. And based on that, you can do a scaling up or down defined policies with the Apache Stratos project. And also, with the support of virtual machine, as well as the containers, we can do the two level of scalability. One is the, for example, if you look at this part, so you can scale up the Docker host cluster since we are supporting the virtual machine level scaling up. So whenever this host cluster is loaded, you can bring a new CoreOS host and make it to the make it available to the Docker cluster, then you can scale up the bottom layer. But if you want to run your application top layer, then it scale up from the Kubernetes cluster. You can create the many containers top of that cluster. So we have two level of scalability. The host cluster also can scalable, and also the containers can scalable in the top level. And another thing is, so like I said, to run platform as services, you need to have infrastructure services. But with this, you can run platform as services without infrastructure services. You can create your Docker cluster or Kubernetes cluster in bare metal machines. Then you can create your PaaS top of this Kubernetes cluster. So that is also a very good thing, because otherwise you have to pay a lot of money to the your infrastructure service provider to get either OpenStack or any other VMware kind of project to run in testing and or in the private cloud scenarios. Okay, this is how we use the Kubernetes resources. So mainly we are using Kubernetes pod and services in the Kubernetes project. We are not using Kubernetes replication control at the moment. So we have working with this Kubernetes project. So there's no callback when you create the Kubernetes replication controller. So so we are working on the get the callback thing, and we can use the replication controller in the Apache Stratos as well. Okay, next thing. So why we need composite application in the platform as service? If you look at the enterprise apps, there's no simple, right? You can't create an enterprise app in single service. You can't create an enterprise app in, say, or not Tomcat, or even a PHP, or Ruby. So we need to have some combination of these services. We need to have some enterprise service bus integration, or API management integration, or message broker integration. There's a lot of complex scenarios. Then how you can define this all these relationship, all these dependencies in your application? So that's why the composite application support we are bringing into the platform as service. For example, with this composite application support, you can define, okay, what are the relationship between two services how many ratio, maybe two ESP service bus need to be one message broker. So that means the Stratos will take care of running all these defined clusters. And then how you can do the termination. When something happened to the one cluster, what should we do in the other cluster? So these are the things we need to take care of when you think about the enterprise application. So with this composite application support, you can define all these dependencies in single blueprint called composite definition in JSON structure. For example, this is one sample in a complex scenario. Say we have C2 and the C2 are two different cartridges. Maybe you can think about in two different services. So here you can define, okay, this service should be scale up if the CPU threshold go more than 60%. So this service should be scale up if the memory threshold go than 80%. And we can say, okay, I need to run minimum two of C2 services in my cluster. I need to run minimum three C services, one minimum three C services in my cluster. Then you can define, okay, since this dependent scaling enable, say you have scale up 3C into the two instance, we have to make sure we have to create four C2 instances that maintain the ratio. So we can, if you define in this, you no need to do the manual creation, to automatically do it from the Stratos level, underneath Stratos component. And also you can define your services, you can group your services, and you can say, okay, some scenarios you have to recreate the group depending on the scaling up scenarios. You can define that, okay, I need to recreate the C2 and C3 in when you want to scale up the, as a group. So all this can be defined in very simple structure. This is, we are representing in the JSON structure. So you can see these are the group and these are the component and what are the startup order. Say if you take the other example, MySQL and Tomcat, if you want to start up MySQL first in your application, you can say, okay, start MySQL first and wait until the MySQL activated and then start a Tomcat. So you can define this stuff. And you can say the termination behaviors, okay, say what happened to the MySQL or what terminated in the Tomcat should be terminated or we can restart it. You can define whatever pattern you need to take in your application. Very simple with JSON structure, there's no complex pattern structure, so you can define in a very simple structure. And also we are providing the UI, graphical UI, you can drag and drop your components and make the application hierarchy very simple way. And also, I will talk about some other, yeah.
Can you go back to one slide?
Yes.
What about the 60% and the
80%? Yeah, I will explain. So you can plug in these policies whenever in the defining the application. I will come to that. Okay, this has some other features. So say if you want to, like I said, Stratos support multi-factor auto-scaling. Many patches only support this HTTP-based auto-scaling. Based on the HTTP request queue, you can do the scaling up or down. But in Stratos, you can do non-HTTP-based auto-scaling, right? Load average on the instance or memory consumption of instance or memory consumption of the application. You can define as a policies. Then you can attach these policies into the your application. It will take care of scaling up or down based on this threshold value. So how we can do is, so here all the cartridges will publish their, say, memory consumption or load average to the CEP. The CEP do the real-time analytic but given time window. Say we also have the concept called prediction the future load. Say all the cartridges can publish their health into CEP. So currently we are using this motion equation. Say given 1 minute time window, so when we publish the memory consumption to a particular service, then CEP will calculate the first derivative and second derivative of this memory consumption. Then autoscale can predict from this motion equation, okay, what is the next minute predicted memory consumption come into this service, and then if it is over the threshold, we can do the early scaling up. So that's again important thing. we need to take the very fast action, the early scale, scaling up concept to make sure the required clusters ready to do the load, serving the load coming into the future. So again, we are working on the fitted curve algorithm to improve this motion equation. We have given another Google Summer School project to the student. He's working on improve this prediction algorithm with the fitted curve algorithm. And the next thing is, so Stratos, like I said, Stratos can also support third-party load balancers, and also Stratos load balancers also can be scaled up. So we can think about load balancers as a cartridges, then this load balancers can publish their health, like maybe the in fact request count, maybe the memory, maybe the CPU consumption. Based on this data, we can create new load balancers, we can scale up new load balancers, then only we need to update the DNS, saying that, okay, there's another load balancer coming into this cluster, then it will do the round robin scenario. And so since all the Stratos use the message broker-based communication, all are in PubSub communication. So since we are using PubSub, you can simply extend Stratos into the indicators your external system. As example, you can bring any third-party load balancers without very large effort. How we can do is, so when we create a container or when we create an instance, we are updating this topic called topology, saying that, okay, there's IP address, is the port number for this particular service. Then whenever we updated this topology, so we can write simple extension. We have already in LB extension. It will subscribe and it will get all the information, and you can get the latest members in your cluster. You can update your load balancers with these new members, and then it will ready to do the load balancing. So using this concept, you can bring any third-party load balancers simply into Stratos with this extension. So this is again a very good feature. Say if you want to run Stratos top up Amazon EC2, so Amazon also has the Amazon load elastic load balancer. They have optimized their load balancer in their environment. So if you want to deploy Amazon in Apache in Amazon, best way to indicate with the Amazon load balancer. So using this architecture, you can simply bring into that integration. So this is how we are doing is all the member information are published in this topology topic. So you can subscribe to this topic and you can get all the information, updated information, and you can do the configuration in your site with your load balancer. Okay, so Stratos also has smart policy concept. So we have namely two smart policies. One is the auto-scaling policy, and other one is the deployment policy. So this is the way how can define the threshold value. So when you define the auto-scaling policy, you can say the memory consumption is 60%, over 60% we should scale up. You can define the policy. Okay, and what is the CPU consumption we need to scale up? You can define in the policy. So auto-scaling policy is mainly you can define the threshold value that need to be scaled up or down. Then the deployment policy. Deployment policy is mainly doing the deployment pattern. Say, if you want to do a high available deployment, say if you want to do a 4.9 or 5.9 of deployment, so how you can achieve it? Nowadays, the DevOps need to be make sure your service is running in different cloud providers, different region, different zones to make this 5.9 or 4.9 availability. So whenever service down, you may alert the DevOps and need to recreate in that particular region, particular zone, to make it available. So if you want to define this in a single policy, saying that this is a high available policy for the 4.9, then I need to create my service in different cloud providers, maybe Amazon and OpenStack. Then I need to create in different regions. In Amazon, you can region A, region B, whatever, you can create it. And within the region, you can mention that, okay, I need to spin up in different zones. So if you define all this information in the policy, then Stratos will make sure when you're creating an instance, it will make sure, okay, the first one should be created in this provider, and this region and this zones. And second instance should be, and we can say, okay, minimum two instances running that particular zone. And we can say the second one should be created in the this provider, this region, and this zone. So it will make sure the what you define in the policy, it will make sure the up and running in all the instances. So it makes the DevOps very easier to manage this high level kind of deployment. And so, okay, this is the way you can define the your threshold value policies into application. So like I said in that JSON example, so you can mention this as a subscriber info, saying that, okay, this policy should be go with this cartridge, then it will make sure all the auto-scaling patterns inherit from the auto-scaling policy defined, and all the deployment patterns inherit from the deployment policy defined, particularly that cartridge. So this is how you can plug into the JSON. Only you have to pass the policy name, auto-scaling policy, and deployment policy when you creating the application. And next thing is the cloud bursting. So since Stratos can run private cloud, public cloud, hybrid cloud, and we can easily do the cloud bursting. Say, why we need the cloud bursting? Say, if I have application and running on the private cloud, and I am getting some seasonal time, getting very load in seasonal time, then either I need to expand my private data center to make available all resources in that my data center. But it has very high cost, right? And wasting our resources in the off-peak time. So with simple Stratos, you can say in that, okay, if you are getting heavy load, burst into the public cloud, maybe a EC2, particular season, it will burst into the EC2, and it will make sure that all the applications are available in the EC2, as well as OpenStack in the private cloud. Then you can update the DNS, you can do the routing with this bursting cloud. And also, this gives very important feature. You can migrate your application one cloud to another cloud without a downtime. Say, if you want to migrate from the OpenStack to the Amazon, we can simply burst into the Amazon and make sure the load balancers running, do the round robin, DNS are doing the round robin routing. Then you can simply shut down the private cloud cluster. We can make sure available in the open public cloud. So that's another important feature. You can make the migration without downtime in your application. And another important features are we are bringing with the logging and metering and monitoring. So for example, say if you are running 100 of instances, it's nightmare to look at every log in the all instances. So we are having the giving the APIs to publish all the log file into central location. Then you can have the filters. You can just use the filters to look at, okay, what happening on this service and this node. Then you can simply look at that. So again, it will bring a lot of help to the cloud DevOps to the life easier for their operations. Okay, so for the demo, so I'm going to use my machine. I have two Kubernetes nodes and one Kubernetes master running on top of VirtualBox. And I have running Stratos, and I will deploy simple application, PHP, and then I will demonstrate how you can increase the load in a particular node, and then how detect the CEP, and how detect it from a Stratos, and how we get the auto scale, creating several other containers automatically. And later I will show how you can update the artifact real time without any issue. Okay, so we'll. Okay, this is, I am running two node in my Kubernetes cluster. So if you look at port, this is a DNS port, by default is running from the Kubernetes cluster. And so this is the Apache Stratos graphical interface. So you can, you can do the configuration on the graphical interface, or you can do the command line or API calls. So since this is a demo, I will use APIs to configure and run the application. Currently no applications running. You can define from the UI also. You can drag and drop the cart-driven cartridges and define it. So I will run from the script to save some time, okay? So I will deploy all the artifacts from the script, and so it will deploy the PHP cartridges, and it will deploy the, it will create the, so you can see. So this is, okay, you can see now it has graphical interface. There's one container creating now, initialization, and it will show the status of life cycle of status for particular application. So it will make sure all the, in this case, it will make sure the Apache is running and get all the artifact from the define. So here I am getting artifact from the Git repository. So later I will show how you can update the artifact while updating the Git repo. It will automatically detect it and update all the cluster. So if you look at Kubernetes now, you can see there's one pod created to my cluster. So it is the Kubernetes cluster is running now. So container is running now. So it will then do the, all the health statistics before giving the activation into the Stratos. Okay, now it's green, that is activated. If I, this is member information, all the address and all the container information, and it's active state. And if you look at the cluster, you can do the access URL. So if I look at that, this is my simple application. So it's, you can access using the one of the service proxy I explained in the Kubernetes. Okay, so now I will generate some load inside this container, then see how it detect from the Stratos and do the scaling up, create the new containers to make the load balancing across this cluster. So it is running on first node. Okay, so this is one node. So if you look at these are the Docker containers running. In the node one, you look at SSH into that container. Okay, so I have some stress tool installed already in this container. I can run this tool. Say I can generate some CPU load inside this container. So we run this and we'll take maybe half a minute or a minute to get the load, and it will detect from the Stratos, and we'll see it automatically scaling up to make sure the required container count it will create automatically. So we'll look at here. So give so maybe 1 minute, so it will detect and it will create containers. So like this is, we are using the non-HTTP based auto-scaling. So I have not defined the load balancers here. So we are generating the load in the container, in the load average in this case. So it will update the CEP with the health statistics publisher. And from CEP, it will do the calculation of, okay, what is the predicted load average particular future, then it will go more than the threshold value, it will create the new instances for that. So if you look at the Kubernetes cluster, okay, if you look at, you can see it is generating a particular load in that cluster. So if you look at, and also if you look at the pod, can see there's no, still one port running, so it will make created new ports whenever it goes over the threshold value. So we'll give a few seconds. Okay, it will create it now, so I will stop the load. So if I go to Stratos now, you can see it will create, it has created another four containers to make sure that the available future load, predicted future load. Now it's two created, two in initial state. All the lifecycle state are monitored and displayed in the dashboard. So it will come active state. Now three are activated. So that's another two is still not activated. Okay, it's still not another two are activated. Look at. If you access from the here load balancer, see if you access from the proxy service, you can see the container IP address are changing. It will do the load balancing. There's some caching also. They are routing the requests are routing in the round robin manner. So, okay. Will you see others activated now? Okay, all five containers are activated now. So, and also, okay, service proxies are running two hosts. For the high availability, either proxy you can access, it will do the load balancing across the multiple host containers that running in the multiple host machine. Okay, now I will update my application. Then I will show without changing Docker file, you can update your application. How we are doing is that we are giving the application artifact in the Git repository. So you can update your application in the Git, then automatically it will trigger it to the artifact distribution coordinator. It will pull and update the application runtime real time without no need to change the Docker file or add the application into that Docker file. So here, this is my simple application. So I will change something here. So I will maybe add QCon demo, so QCon New York. And I will git commit. And I will git push. Okay. Now, if I access this one, it will automatically detect and pull the application. Okay, it's already updated now. So like, so this is how you can update the scale cluster without doing any Docker file change or kind of thing. Okay, so I can take any questions if you have. Yeah.
I have two questions. So with the Git interface, can you control where to pull from, like from certain branches? So
yeah. Okay. The application, you can control which branches or which repository you can. So it is in the, I didn't show that. So if you look at, these are the, I already deployed from the from the script. So if you look at this application, you can see, you can give which repository you want to pull, then you can give whatever development repository, or you can update the branch or in the agent saying that, okay, this branch should be the production and this one should be the testing and all this stuff.
Right, and you just call the repository or you can use the hooks?
You can use hooks, this is hooks.
Hooks.
Yeah, so you can get the GitHub also, you can GitHub, you can give the ADC IP and port, uh-huh. It will do the hook, it will trigger it, and from the ADC it will look at, okay, which services are referring this repository, It will not send the notification to all the instances saying that, okay, there's update coming for this repository. Please take a pull and update your repository. Sorry.
Are you planning to do more cartridges for yes. different
type of apps? Yeah. So, for example, again, this is since a community project, people are contributing in the cartridges, but we also trying to provide by default more cartridges. Any other questions? Okay. I have 5 minutes. No questions. Okay, thank you very much.